question. One question for all of you. Who the heck are they? Have you ever wondered who they are? The experts say this, the experts say that. I do know one thing. If you get 50 experts in a room, you're gonna get 50 different opinions. And then it's up to you to decide which opinion you want to believe. And maybe, just maybe, that makes you the expert on your life. I had times in my life where I could have listened to the famous they, but instead, I chose to listen to me. Thank you so much for having me here. It's such an honor. I'm so excited to be speaking on behalf of CIMSE, a place where their headquarters are, is just a few miles from where I call home. And the philanthropic impact, just as I saw the donation tonight for Habitat for Humanity, the generosity from CIMSE, as well as their community involvement, I can tell you just in the state of Idaho, is a game changer. And I can't thank but all of you for creating magical moments in those in need. I'm thrilled to be here, and I can't thank Heidi and Orville Thompson enough for the opportunity to share my magical moment. Though I'm here to inspire all of you, I'm telling you, 24 hours ago when I arrived to the Marriott and I saw you guys walking around the hotel, you guys have already inspired me. You guys are having fun. You love what you're doing, and so I'm going to do my best to inspire you even more than you already are. You guys right now may be scratching your head thinking, well, what does some chick in spandex that rides around have in common with any of you? I mean, for real. I don't know each of you personally. However, through some brief research of mine, I think it's safe to assume the number one thing that we all share and we have in common is that we are committed to excellence. And throughout my athletic and professional career, I've been fortunate to have been around and surrounded by extraordinary people, extraordinary achievers, and it's been interesting to see how they differentiate themselves from the rest of the population. And I'm not saying that anyone is created differently than someone else, because I do believe that we're all born and created the same. However, what I'm referring to is how they go about and how they go about thinking in their lives. It's very different. Vince Lombardi once said, "The quality of a person's life is in direct proportion to their commitment to excellence, regardless of their chosen field or endeavor." So here we go. What does commitment to excellence mean to each of you? For me, excellence is a state of mind. It's just an attitude. This afternoon, this evening, we're on the edge. I want to share part of my story with you so that I can pull out examples, which I hope along the way will help you down your path of excellence. I've gone through 4 Olympic Games, and each of these, I call them my journeys. In each journey, were completely unique. It took me 12 years in the sport of competing at the highest level to figure out exactly what it took to consistently be at the top of the sport, the pinnacle of sport, year after year, time after time. But even through these journeys, there were always my highs, my lowest of lows, my plateaus, and even on top of the peaks, all the stars had to be aligned. And even when the stars were aligned, I had to have a little luck on my side. And the problem with all of that is I just keep getting older. So here we go. We're gonna bring you back to my first Olympic Games, and you may not realize this, because I only have 3 gold medals to my name, but I actually have competed in 4 Olympic Games. And I equate my Olympic Games, my first one in Athens, Greece, the birthplace of the Olympics, is kind of like my first job. I was a deer in headlights. My first Olympic Games, I had no idea what I was doing, what I was supposed to do. In fact, I was the kid who never was told they had anything great. I didn't have a high school, I wasn't on an all-star team. I didn't get a collegiate scholarship. When I tested in the labs, on paper, I was nothing. But here's the deal, I made it. It was a highlight of my career. I mean, think about it. Any amateur athlete, they think of the Olympic Games as the pinnacle of sport. I made it. I didn't know what I was doing, but on my way to be part of the Olympic team, I had a friend call me up and he said, "Hey, I got a piece of advice for you." I'm like, "Oh, here they go again. Like, give it to me. I'm sure everyone has a piece of advice for me." He said, "Don't forget to compete." I was like, "What do you mean, don't forget to compete? I'm a competitor." It's like you're showing up to a party and forgetting to kind of sell a product. You just don't do that. He's like, "Don't forget to compete." So sure enough, I show up, I go to the opening ceremonies, I stand on my feet for like 13 hours, I get home and I compete about 12 hours later, and before I knew it, I was back home in Boise, Idaho on the couch watching the closing ceremonies thinking, what just happened to me? Oh, that friend of mine, I forgot to compete. Here's what happened, I had a goal. I had a goal, and the goal was even a surprise to me. I made the Olympic team. I didn't have a vision. I had no vision to support my goal. So guess what? I showed up to Athens, the Olympic Games, and I forgot to compete because I had nothing after that goal that I had set. So my first takeaway from my first journey in Athens was you have to have a vision. A vision is going to help clarify that plan. And if you don't have a plan, you can't act on what you want to do. What's your dream? As you take each step and it becomes closer and closer, you stay focused. You don't have to see every stair step in that staircase. But you have to trust the process in order to get to that vision. So after this week, after the family reunion is done and dusted, and you have another year till the next one, what you've taken, how you've networked, what you've shared from your team members, from other team members who are successful, how are you going to act on that? What are you going to do? What's your vision? Is it a shared vision? Do you have a shared vision with your team? Think about it. Do you have clarity around what you want to do? And if you do, have you mapped it out? So here we go, 4 years to the next Olympic Games. And I tell you what, I thought the only goal I had was to make the Olympic team. Well, I brought in a vision. I'm going to go for Beijing, and I want nothing less than to be on the top step of the podium in Beijing. But here's the deal. When I first started in Athens, it was me, myself, and I. Of course, I had this boyfriend of mine who was scared to propose to me for years. I mean, he liked to travel with me. It was pretty cool. He was dating this girl who wins Olympic Games and all this stuff. But he was a huge supporter. But I didn't have a team behind me because I thought I could do it on my own. So I go to Beijing, and things have to be different. This time around, I'm going to fly over to Beijing, I'm going to recon the course. And you won't believe this, but just 10 years ago, we would take it on our Google, on our device, and We came home and I downloaded it, and my engineer boyfriend at the time, he overlaid it on Google Maps. Imagine that technology. That's like old school now, like that would be like too much work, because now you can just like, oh yeah, plot it out on ride the GPS and it's there. But boy, we were like, we were on the edge, we were doing everything. We went to the wind tunnel down in San Diego, where cars and planes go, and they test your drag. You want to have the lowest drag in the sport of cycling. Everything counts. Mm-hmm. It's you against the clock. We had a bike that weighed 15 pounds, which, mind you, the weight limit is 15 pounds. You can't go under it. I had a bike 2.5 pounds lighter than the next competitor. I had a bike 2.5 pounds lighter than the next male competitor. I had the top male competitor come over and pick my bike up because he couldn't believe it. That's what a team helped me do. I had to let go and understand that I wasn't the expert, nor was I the best in everything. I had to hire the best. I had to work with a dietitian. I had to work with a mechanic. I had to work with a coach. It was the 1% that makes you on or off the podium. Here's my takeaway. Beijing. It took a team, and you're kidding yourself today if you think you can do it alone. And I can already tell, I've listened from you from backstage. You guys know what teamwork is. You guys are a team. You're one team in this room, and you're amazing. But just like you, if an athlete like myself feels trusted by those around them, it's highly likely that they're gonna feel empowered. The more trust there is in a relationship, the higher the motivation levels. And I'm sure this all holds true in life, in anything you do. So I ask you this, I have to challenge you on every one of my journeys. Are you empowering and inspiring those around you? And how do you continually motivate and inspire others to believe in your business and to be part of your team? Think about it. So I'm retired, I decided I'm done, I wanna have a family. I mean, I won the gold medal, what's next? I mean, seriously, in life, again, they told me I should get married, they told me I should have a family, and well, now I'm in my 30s, and this hasn't happened. So I retire, and we were fortunate, we got pregnant pretty quickly, and about 7 months into pregnancy, 8 months into pregnancy, I get a text message. And it's my coach, and he's like, hey, what do you think? Like, I don't know, we've got like 22 months. What do you think about a new goal? I'm like, have you seen me lately? Like, this thing is probably not gonna get on a bike. Although I was riding quite a bit, and I felt great pride in passing people when I was 8 months pregnant, but that's another story. Because sometimes when you have that competitive drive and blood in your body, it doesn't go away. So I said, yeah, not that interested. So the due date came, we deliver a beautiful, healthy child, and it wasn't but 2 days later, I had a text message from my old coach, Jim Miller, and he's like, what do you think, champ? Now he's talking to me like an athlete, not a mom. He's like, 22 months, what do you think? And I was like, I take my phone and I show it to my husband and I said, what is this all about? And he starts laughing. And I'm like, oh, okay, what's going on between the two? Oh, okay, let me just get down to it. We kind of have a bet. We thought, well, because you went on this charity ride in August and you were like about 1 month to delivering Lucas and you couldn't get dropped. You had to keep up with like the top guys. I kind of just told him that I don't think you're done yet. And I was like, oh, okay, now I know the story. So after about 2 weeks, I actually get a little bit of sleep. I was like, you know what? This is gonna be a fun goal, let's do it. So I text my coach back and I'm like, I'm in, let's do it. So November 1, we full on go into training. And it was about every 3 weeks, I'm like, oh, what am I doing? This is awful. Why did I sign up for this? But I told the whole world I'm doing it. So now I'm accountable to like everybody else and even myself. And so we went on, and my husband said, this is going to be a family affair. I'm going to support you. Lucas is going to support you. We're going to do this together. Okay. 5 months after I deliver Lucas, I'm on a plane. I show up to the airport. It's my first race back. I have a pack and play. I have my bikes. I have my Bob stroller. And I'm like, what has happened to me? I'm at the start line. I'm handing my husband Lucas after breastfeeding. I go ride for 3 hours. I race my bike for 3 hours, only to cross the finish line with my husband, handing Lucas back sunburned. And it's like, here. And I'm like, yeah, I need to breastfeed again. I get back to the team van, and all I can hear are these women saying, oh my gosh, I don't want mayonnaise on my recovery sandwich. And what time is my massage? And I'm just like, oh, these princesses. I'm not gonna get a sandwich or I'm gonna get a massage. I'm just gonna like go home and be mom. So time goes on, I go to national championships, and again, I don't do well. I'm in Augusta, Georgia. I get third place. And because the headlines say Kristen can't make a comeback because I didn't win. So they are dictating who I am again. But because of that, I decided I'm done. I quit. It's too much. My husband said, I don't blame you. Let's quit. But here's the problem. That team of mine, they're like, oh, no, 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 no. You're in this. We're in this. And we've gone too far. You're not quitting. I'm like, oh, gosh. So the problem with having a team is now you're accountable to like not just one person, yourself. You're accountable to like your team. So you can't leave. Got news for you guys. You can't leave. So I took a deep breath. Okay, I'm coming back. And because the World Championships was chosen off a coach's selection, I got chosen in August because of the history I had in the sport, only to find out that I was going to get arbitrated against. Arbitration means when an athlete doesn't agree with a coach's selection, at any time, an athlete can disagree and bring you to court. If they lose in court, it doesn't really matter. You still pay the fine, they pay the fine. It is what it is. So I'm on the plane to Copenhagen, and my coach and I decide we have to go with our plan, we have to trust the process, and we have to decide whether we're gonna show up and compete, or we're gonna show up and see if we won or lost arbitration. He goes, we're flying to Copenhagen. I get on a plane to Copenhagen, I land, only to find out, I turn my phone on and it says, I'm sorry, you've lost arbitration, and USA Cycling will be at the baggage claim to check you back in and fly you home. I'm like, I quit. I'm done. I texted my whole team. I'm out. What you may not know is if you get top three in the World Championships, you're an automatic for the Olympic Games. So about four days later, the World Championship happens. I go on live stream at 5 a.m., and I've never rooted so hard against Team USA in my entire life. So I'm like, if they lose, that means I win. And oh, they were bad. They were so bad. So about 2 hours after the race, I texted my whole team and said, you know what? I've had some time to think about it. And I think I jumped the gun. I'm back in. So here we go, full on. 2012 comes our way. Every race I show up to, I'm going to be prepared for it. And I'm going to nail it. People locally were like, what are you doing with your time trial bike? I mean, you're showing up like you're at the World Championships. I'm like, yep, Boise, Idaho, it's the World Championships. So everything I did, I won. I won one race after the other. I wasn't going to leave anything on the table. The largest race, the largest head-to-head race before the Olympic selection, 3 weeks prior to the Olympic selection, came to my hometown, Boise, Idaho. It was the last time for me to prove to everybody that I can be a champion again. Six stages, Stage one, it was a time trial, short time trial. And I go around the corner and I crash. 9 weeks before the Olympic Games, I break my collarbone. I go into surgery the next morning, I wake up, and the headline of the paper is, Armstrong's out, there's no way she can make a comeback. I come to out of surgery, my husband and the physician are over me saying, we got a plan. And I'm just like, are you for real? Like, we're gonna go out to stage two and we're gonna show everybody that nothing's gonna take you down. Okay, so I get in the car, we go out to stage two, I have a jacket on, I just came out of surgery, and the media comes running up to me saying, we thought you broke your collarbone. Like, they were doubting me. I said, I just got out of surgery. And they're like, well, can we do a story on you? I said, yeah, on one condition. The headline reads, nothing takes Armstrong down. The power of social media, I used it. I would get on my bike, I'd get off my bike, I took pictures of myself. I'm like, it's amazing to be back on the bike again. Because they were on the selection committee and they were about to make a big decision on my future. And if one person on the selection committee broke their collarbone when they were 9 years old and didn't recover, well, that means that Chris Armstrong can't recover from a collarbone break. So basically I would get on my bike, take a picture and say, this is amazing. I was only on it for 30 seconds. And so I got selected for the Olympic team. My vision, my dream, every morning I would wake up and all I cared about was having my two-year-old on the podium with me, listening to the national anthem. And that happened. So my takeaway from London, balance and my passion for what I do is my secret weapon. When people felt sorry for me that I was a mom, when people said, how can you be so selfish? It was my balance, it was my strength. Because guess what, when I had a bad ride, when I had a bad race, I had a smiling two-year-old that didn't really care. You is when you set goals, make sure that you keep the passion. And of course, in order to succeed, you have to have a process. But keep the passion on the forefront and the back end. Always bring that passion back in. To me, passion is you do it because you can. And no matter the challenges and successes, you wake up each and every morning and you absolutely love what you do. And you want to bring the best to the world. So I have to ask you, what motivates you each and every morning when you wake up? Have you been able to keep the passion around what you do? Or are you getting bogged down in the process and what has to happen? It's important to bring that passion back in the game. And it's natural to lose it at moments, but it's important to bring it back. So here I am, retired, done, 3 hip surgeries. I'm working full-time at the health system in town. And one day, I say, gosh, Joe, I kind of miss having a goal. And he's like, what are you talking about? I was like, you know, just a little goal, kind of like I'm working full-time, just like a marathon runner. You know, marathon runners will, you know, they'll like run a marathon, you know, once or twice a year. Like, no big deal. I'm just thinking about like, let me find an event that I can do just to kind of like, I don't know, keep me motivated, healthy. He's like, well, what are you thinking? And I'm like, I don't know, like nationals. It's no big deal. It's in Chattanooga, Tennessee. And I can just focus on it in May and just be done with it. He's like, okay, here we go. And I'm like, oh, I didn't remind him that if you win nationals, you're an automatic for worlds. He didn't need to know though. So I go and, well, I win. And I was like,
no big deal.
And so sure enough, he's like, okay. And I'm like, but the cool thing is the world championships are in the United States, in Richmond, and they've never been in the United States in my entire career. And here's the deal. If you get top three at Worlds, you go to the Olympic Games. But listen, I promise you, if I don't get top three, I'm out. He's like, okay. So I go to Richmond, I get fifth. I'm like, but, I am top American. Doesn't that say something? And so he's like, okay. I said, but we have to do it right this time. I'm working full time, I'm a mom, and I'm trying, that's why I got fifth, honey, is because I just didn't have the time to do it right. And I got a little cocky. And so we went back to the game. We did everything we possibly could. We went to Palm Desert. We took my family. We put everything in. But this time, when I got to this point in my journey, the formula had to change once again. I got home from Richmond, and I was going home on my cruiser bike because I thought, well, if I'm a cyclist, maybe I shouldn't drive my car as much. I'm going home on my cruiser bike. I'm about 30 seconds from home, and sure enough, I herniate a disc. So here we go again. It's not worth it. Why would I even go forward? November 11th, 2015, I have spine surgery. My physician said, don't touch your bike till January 1st. January 1, I get on my bike. It's like up and down, up and down, up and down. I quit a million more times. I'm out, I can't deal with this anymore. And mind you, the whole time when I made a comeback, my friends in the sport, well, they're telling me that I'm too old, I'm selfish, it's their turn. That's my favorite thing, it's their turn. We take turns now, you know? It's about participation, it's not about winning. Here's the deal, the same thing goes on. Coach's selection shows up. And lo and behold, I get chosen, but guess what? Same story, different year, I get arbitrated. There's a GoFundMe campaign online where a female racer raised $25,000 to take me to court to fight against this decision.
That's ridiculous.
3 weeks before Rio, I'm in arbitration for 12 hours. $32,000 later, I win. Imagine this. 1 week later, 1 week before Rio, I show up to my last race, and the girl who arbitrated against me shows up to race against me. She beats me. I crossed the finish line, and I said, I quit. 2 weeks before Rio, 1 week before I fly, and somebody came to me and said, you know what? Your team is going to tell you they love you, and no matter the result, it doesn't matter. It's time you talk to somebody else outside of your team. You need to talk to this coach. They hand me the phone. It's my friend Dean. I don't even know him. I know him, but just know of him. He gets on the phone and said, what's your problem? And I go, I suck. And he said, no, let's not go that way. He goes, how did you feel? I said, I feel awful. I said, but my power's there. I'm good. Physically, I know I'm my best. He goes, well, then that's good news. He goes, are you stressed? And I said, oh, I'm stressed all right. He goes, stress is the real deal. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to go home. I want you to be around people who care about you, people who believe in you, and people who love you. And everything's gonna work out. My takeaway, yes, I end up on the podium. I win again. By 5 seconds in a 43-minute race. My takeaway is strong character. This is the foundation of success. Throughout my athletic career, I've experienced suffering and struggle, success, elation, celebration, injuries, losses, setbacks. They've all developed my greatest character traits, which is resilience, grit, focus, and determination. I have the ability to learn from my struggles and my failures. My successes in sport have been built upon humility and empathy and compassion and gratitude. What strong character traits are you bringing to the table? How are you responding to success and failure when times are tough? In 2004, I became an Olympian in Athens, Greece, 2 years after signing my first pro contract because I quit fighting the norm. I quit my job, I lived paycheck to paycheck, and I poured my heart and soul into the sport I loved. In 2008, I won the 2008 TT in Beijing, 7 years after a change had thrust upon me because I was not afraid of change. I won the gold medal 4 years after losing in Athens because I had believed in my vision and I had a team behind me. In 2012, I won the individual time trial in London, 22 months after delivering my child, because I was not afraid of continuing to do what I love to do, even though I was a mom. I won the gold medal because I was even stronger. I had a stronger vision. That vision of being on the podium with my son, having family brought me balance, which was my secret weapon. And of course, my team continued to believe in me. I let passion drive me versus getting bogged down in the process. In 2016, I won the individual time trial in Rio, making U.S. history as the only summer female athlete to win 3 consecutive gold medals in the same discipline. Not to mention, I was turning 43. I won the gold medal 9 months after having spine surgery and 2 years after my third hip surgery. I came out of retirement for the second time. I took a risk. And people continually asked me why. And my answer was simply put, because I can. Each time they said the odds were stacked against me, they were wrong. This is my gold medal. I'm happy to finally say that I figured out who they are. They are the last ones to jump on the bandwagon when times are good. They are the first ones to jump off when the going gets tough. They are the people who will dwell on the problems. They are the people who will point out your weaknesses, your problems, and your troubles. They are the people who say you can't. Not because you can't, because they can't. I want to leave you today with just one of my favorite quotes, and it really helps me keep things in perspective. After the cheers have died down and the stadium is empty, after the headlines have been written, and after you're back in the quiet of your room, and then championship ring, medal, award has been placed on the dresser, and all the pomp and fanfare has faded, the enduring things that are left are the dedication to excellence, the dedication to victory, and the dedication to doing with our lives the very best we can to make the world a better place in which to live. Best of luck as you go on to your pursuit of excellence and as you experience many magical moments of your own. Thank you.